Hey everybody, I know everyone's been waiting a little bit of a while for me to deploy this video about deploying Ceph. Basically, we're just going to go through a script really fast that I've made to pre-build Ceph or get it ready. So let's jump in. Essentially, this starts with this, changes the host name, right? Pretty simple, no problems. Next, we're going to add our DNS server and disable the UFW firewall. After that, we're going to clear our current SSH keys and generate new ones. Right? Basic stuff still. Then we create the Ceph user. No biggie. We add the Ceph repository. We make some system control changes. Not too shabby, right? Then finally, last but not least, we have a little script at the bottom there that goes through converting the current DHCP address to a static. That's just the way I prefer to do things. I'm going to make this available in the little box down below the video, and it just goes through step by step. No biggie, you know. It will prepare a machine for Ceph. And the way I use this is like flashes, right? I'll deploy Ubuntu to a flash, and then I'll run the script or copy the script to it, and then just run it a bunch of times. Let's jump in. So let's assume this is a flash of Ubuntu server, and we're just going to run the first, you know, copy Ceph deploy. Now I've already copied to the original image the Ceph setup script, the script we just finished reviewing. It doesn't actually run Ceph. All it does is prepare the node for Ceph, and we're basically kicking this guy on. And let's actually create the environment, right? So that was the deployment server. It runs Ceph deploy, no biggie. We're gonna create three monitors. You just have to bear with me for all of this. We're doing this from scratch. None of these machines have anything prepared on them except for just having the script in the user's home folder, right? And basically all I did is install Ubuntu, download the script onto the home folder, and, you know, plus exit. So there it is right there. We're gonna kick that off. Actually, let me see. Let me sudo su. Okay. It's asking me what the system's name is. It's already Ceph deploy. I already, when I created the image, I named the host name Ceph deploy. Pardon me. And this takes a little bit, so it's doing its thing. So the user right now in the script, when it creates a Ceph user, the default password is fastpass with an exclamation point at the end. If you actually look inside the script, you can see that. You don't have to use my script. I just prefer it as a very easy means to deploy these guys much quicker. So now I'm going to create the OSD servers. These are the disk servers, right? Traditionally, you want about a gigahertz of processor and about 4 gigs of RAM per OSD, right? Per disk that you're attaching as an OSD, those are your rough requirements. For the monitors, you want I'm gonna add a disk here. So this is gonna be our OSD disk. But for the monitors, you just wanna make sure /var is mounted to like an SSD. The monitors dictate the speed at which the cluster will move, and if they have less to do disk wise, the faster the whole cluster will run, right? I'm just going to make this 100 gig even. There you go. Now, if you're marveling at the speed at which I am cloning and creating these things, please don't. This is basically just a basic install image with just SSH running. Though it is running on one of those SSD cards instead of a SSD normal disk drive there, so it's pretty beefy. Each system right now in my virtual environment's got 2 gigs of RAM and I believe 1 proc, or is it 2? I don't remember. Nonetheless, let's get started. So That guy's done. We rebooted. Logging in as Ceph using FastPass exclamation point. Now we're going to go get the Ceph deploy Debian file. At this current moment in time, the Debian repository does not include Ceph deploy, or not the current version anyway. So I had to go get it manually. I will also include the link to the actual repo location in the video. They're just gonna install this guy. It needs so there's that. They're gonna install the original guy. And there we go. Okay, it's up and running. We're gonna run Ceph deploy, and we're actually gonna create the template for the cluster now, right? Actually, hold on. Make sure all the disks are properly sized. Set up the monitors. And all of these guys, we're going to run the script on. Every single one. The system tweaks really apply to the OSD servers, but I just run them on all because there's no reason for them not to have the same tweaks. You get a lot of network overhead. Like I said, I will be providing links to any external sources I do use in this. Systems are dragging on a little bit, so we'll just keep doing more of them. Now, in this particular video, I'm going to be showing you how to use Ceph deploy. My next video on this is going to go into detail on deployment without Ceph deploy. It's significantly harder and has a lot more overhead overall, but it's preferred to do it that way when you're using Puppet or Chef or Ansible, you know, any type of automation tools. It would be best to do these things more manually, because that way you don't have to keep track of the Ceph deploy machine. Typically what I do is, once the Ceph deploy machine at a site has deployed Ceph, I actually shut it down. I try to use VMs so that they can back it up, but you don't need to back it up. You can always install a fresh Ceph deploy, do a gather keys against the monitor, and it will then be able to work on the Ceph environment, right? So, but typically you just shut them down. Anytime you need to add new machine and new disk to an existing environment, you just kick on your Ceph deploy and you just have at it. Real simple. Ceph has got some pretty amazing features. About 10 minutes into a drive failure, the drive is outed from the cluster and everything backfills, right? And, you know, you're up and you never go down. That way, anyway, until you run out of disk space. That would be tragic, right? But the whole key to this is that you always just keep adding disk space. Every time you need more IOPS, you add more disk. Every time you need more space, you add more disk. And they probably pay you too much money where you're working to replace disks. That's what I always say. I told my boss that. I say, hey, listen, you pay me too much to walk around replacing disks. So I usually wait till the end of the quarter to go around and pop all the dead disks and re-add them. Basically, in Ceph, when a disk fails, you actually delete it out of the cluster. It gets outed after 10 minutes, meaning that, you know, nobody's trying to use it after 10 minutes. And you basically just yank the disk. You delete it from the cluster when you're ready to replace it, and then you add it like as if you're adding a new disk, a new OSD. and it'll just take up whatever spot's been missing, you know? Like if you build 1 through 10 OSDs and you 4 dies and they delete it from the cluster, the next time you add a new OSD, it will take 4. You know, it's not going to give it, you know, 11. Though I guess technically that would be possible. So we're just going to keep going through all these servers, launching our Ceph setup scripts. Sorry for the boringness of this all, but I wanted to make sure that we caught all of this on video, step by step. We don't want to confuse anybody. I'm just going to kick this guy's on. This guy's not showing up on my screen. But for whatever reason, it's showing up in the little image in the virtual console. But whatever. I mean, I can work off that, right? Let's see. Sappho is the O2. This guy's going. This is going to be a long video. A little over half an hour. We're just gonna see what we can do here. Here's number 3 coming up. Let's kick the script off. So far, as we said, all we've done is kick the machines on, ran the script, right? Except for the deployment machine. We installed Python setup tools, and we did a dpkg-i on the actual Ceph deploy Debian file. We haven't done anything else yet. That's all we've done. So imagine you've installed 6 fresh Ubuntu servers, or 7 in our case. Sorry for the background noise here, that's just my switch. We got O1 going, even though I had no screen to work with except for that little preview. I don't know why I did that, maybe it had something to do with the the video capture method I'm using. I'm using the NVIDIA Shadow Play to do this, which is not laggy at all. Let's snapshot all these guys now that we got the Ceph set up running on all of them, and we got Ceph deploy installed, and then we'll proceed after this. All right, now what we're gonna do is we're gonna reboot all these guys. We're going to collect up the IPs. Now, they should all be sequential. And like I said, part of the script was to convert the DHCPs to static. So these are not going to change anymore. And we need to use DNS names for these machines, at least for the deployment process. You should always use a name for the monitors, because you want to be able to call them via DNS, because you know you're not going to put a host's record on every one of your servers. So you want to be able to get a highly available DNS set up to at least point to monitors. Once they're on a monitor, the monitor will actually deliver the IP of the OSD servers that are involved in the data. So you don't have to worry about it at that point. But during installation, we're going to have to set up a hosts list on each one of the systems, I actually think you only need it on the Ceph deploy system, but what the hell, we're gonna do it anyway. Because once we build one script, it's, you know, or not script, once we build one host, it's really no skin off our backs. Not to mention that the host names of these guys are now different than what's in the hosts list. So we have to go in and edit that anyway. For whatever reason, the Ubuntu host name control does not modify the hosts. It just edits the host name. So we're going to go in here and we're going to start collecting up the IPs. We're going to put them in this list. We're going to generate a new hosts file. We're going to upload it to all our machines. Right now, I just kind of wrote that out. I'm just going to verify that these are true. The DHCP should give them linearly, but you never know. Doing a quick verify. I'm going to put this in the hosts here. And this is all the boring stuff. So, I mean, if you want to stick around for this, be my guest. If you want to fast forward through this part, that's fine. But I'm going to spend the next few minutes typing this in and then copying this to all the servers, the monitors, and the OSDs. Though, like I said, I'm pretty sure you only really need this on the deploy server. And I would set them up on the monitors as well. But just the monitors. Like right now I'm doing monitor 01, monitor 02, monitor 03. You need those. You don't necessarily need the OSDs. As far as I recall in its operation, you don't need OSDs to be in this list, but in a normal setup, this is actually done by a highly available name server anyway. So you'd set up your highly available name server. Crap. I'll save this somewhere else. Well, let's see if I can get a... Oh, geez, I'm in a terminal, aren't I? So I'm not going to be able to just copy it. Okay, we'll just save it somewhere else. You'd set up a highly available DNS and you'd set up the monitors on the highly available DNS. And once the monitors are connected to the OSDs, it's all by IP from there. But normally what I do is I set them all up on the DNS, all of them. And like I said, in my traditional deployments, I set up a DHCP server temporarily. We run the script, it makes those IPs static on each machine. We shut off the DHCP server, it goes away. So only future OSD hosts have to be manually IP'd, because all the initial setup guys, they get their IP from DHCP and then that's converted to a static in the script. I do prefer Ubuntu Server over CentOS or Red Hat. Though Red Hat kind of bought out InkTank, so major support for this is pretty much only going to be available for Red Hat or CentOS. Let's copy this guy in place. And I do again apologize for the low quality of the audio and video, but kind of was spending most of my time just making sure that the order of operations is correct and that you can see step by step every moment of the way what is actually happening. So here you can see I'm copying. I'm using SCP. Just copying the host file locally to each one of the VMs. And once that's done, we'll actually go to them and copy it and place the correct location. See, right now it gave me that error saying that couldn't resolve because the hosts is incorrect. And it's been incorrect. Like I said, the syscontrol, though I should add a sed line to that script to change that in hosts, but what does it matter since you're going to override them anyway, right? Just for future streamlining, I suppose. You can see that the vast majority of this prep work is just getting the systems ready. It's not actually anything to do really with Ceph. You're just prepping them for Ceph. This actual Ceph installation using Ceph deploy is a mere few minutes. I mean, it's really not bad at all once you get everything set up properly. But the all the work really is in the prep, which is why they, you know, really recommend you use, you know, Ansible or Puppet or Chef or anything to help automate this whole situation. Because doing this by hand for 60, 70, 100 servers, difficult. You know, I did my script and that just helps me, that shell script, you know, when I'm doing small deployments. I won't do that on larger ones, right? Especially when you have something like Ansible Tower at your disposal. But for this one, it's no biggie, and I can just drop it in the Brothers Green, call it the doobly-doo. AVE also calls it that. I guess for all intents and purposes, that's what we'll call it. I'll put all the links in the doobly-doo. And you can download that. Please, please examine the script before using it. I am not responsible for anything that occurs from usage of that script, okay? I'm just letting you know that. Change the host name so that they're proper here. I'm going to be rebooting all of these after I'm done with this, just to make sure that everything's nice and clean. Switches are loud, I know. Doing our pings here. Never hurts to test, you know? Because if it doesn't work, then you're puzzled as to why. But if you've been testing it along the whole way, you know, the second one of them doesn't do as it's told, you'll know immediately what's going on. So always test along the way. We're going to be doing that too, even when we use the Ceph deployer. We're going to be checking, you know, version information just to make sure that they did get all the... So as I just did a key gen there, and I'm going to copy the keys over to all the... everyone involved here, because we're going to SSH from this guy, from the deployment server. And, when we SSH in, we want it to be a passwordless SSH. So we're just going to copy it to all the systems. So that was just an SSH key gen with all blank fields. I'm going to do this copying here. And again, this is all through the Ceph user, which the script generated. And it's running on, if you've copied the script exactly, the user, the password is fastpass with an exclamation at the end. Once we get the SSH keys copied, we'll be able to SSH in pretty much without a password. And that's what Ceph deploy uses to set up everything, right? The Ceph deploy the setup script, the one that I provided in the beginning, that automatically adds it to the sudo group, a passwordless sudo. So, or sudo, I don't know how people pronounce that. So that it can just execute commands as necessary via Ceph deploy. So we're going to go ahead and actually hold on. Let's see. Yeah, let's test it. I'm going to test it. Let's test it. Is it frozen here? What's going on? Okay. Okay, now, sorry about the delay there, I got phones going off. Where the heck is it? Okay. Let's add the SSH config. So I just went into the cd.ssh for the Ceph user. I did create the config file. And this is the basic, very, very basic setup here. It's just host, the host name. Then you actually drop down, tab in, and host name, the actual host name again. And just type user Ceph, right? So every command name is capitalized. And all your regular stuff's not. So I'm just going to put that in for every host. Again, you can skip past all this if you've got the gist of it. I'm just covering from beginning to end how this is going to work. And if I was to SSH in here, obviously I could copy paste via PuTTY, you know, but I'm just doing these on the consoles to show, you know, no tricks. This is how you deploy a Ceph cluster. And again, I know we still haven't actually started deploying Ceph yet. We will, don't worry. This is all prep. Now, it would be interesting if they added to the hosts the ability to call another file, like a config file. But they've never done that. That would make it a lot easier. I could actually generate a host script on the fly. There's my test there. Looks like it's working. So, at this point, we're ready to start running some Ceph deploy. So I'm going to do menu Ceph Mono 1, Ceph Mono 2, Ceph Mono 3. This basically pre-creates a monitor key that it's going to send out to all three of these guys and share. This is not actually doing anything at the moment to the Ceph cluster. This is just generating files locally. All right, so you see it's done already. Now we're going to actually install Ceph on the same guys here. It's not actually installed yet. So we're going to let this go. And then once this is done, it's going to take a little bit. Once this is done, we're going to check the version of Ceph installed on these guys, because I've actually had it before where for some reason or another the repository doesn't click on the apt-get updates and it installs an older version from the actual Ubuntu repos and everything breaks. We don't want that. I'm going to try to avoid that like the plague. We're on 02 here. You can actually see the computer that it's doing stuff on the left there. 3. Okay, let's do the version check. And that was just FastPass subversion. That's the current one. Check it. Above all else, it doesn't have to be the most current one, but it has. They do have to be the same. When you're doing updates on Ceph, you always update the monitors first, and then you start updating the OSDs. Since the monitors control everything, it's very dangerous to try to merge the systems together and then just do a big update all at once. So it's best that you break out your monitors from your OSD hosts, but you can actually get away with just having three systems, installing monitors and OSDs on them. We're going to go ahead and do mon creation now. So Ceph deploy, mon create, and then your monitors. Since we checked our versions and they're all good, so it's gonna do this here. Okay, that's done. We're gonna do a quick test to see if Ceph is actually running now. And it's not, so we have to do a gather keys on our Ceph deploy gather keys and just point it at the monitor and it should spread out the keys, right? Okay, now we do a Ceph test here again. Should actually be running now. And there it is. So we have no OSDs at this time, that's why it's a 64 page, you know, PG stuck. But we have a functioning cluster now. Our monitors are actually up. So we're going to go ahead and install the OSDs. So at this time, we're basically adding our storage servers because our monitors are up and running. And literally, this is it. Like, look how quickly this goes once all the prep work is done. I mean, it basically had a half an hour of prep work. And, you know, this is all gravy. Now, I intend to eventually release more videos, you know, setting up RBDs, setting up iSCSI targets, setting up CephFS, little in-depth stuff. Beyond just the installation, but this is a initial deployment, super easy, no big deal type stuff. Just needed to get this out of the way. As you can tell, I don't have a script for this. This is kind of all off the cuff. I did have to break a little bit in the middle of the video there when we went from the snapshots to actually running the software, because I had to take a break. But, you know, like I said, anytime you see this stuff that you've basically got the gist of it, feel free to skip ahead. I'm just trying to get all of this in to a take without having an issue. We're going to check our versions again. You should always do this. Okay, so we don't have anything mounted on those block volumes yet, but we do see that SDB is our disk, and I added one disk to each one, so we can go ahead and start the Ceph deploy. Doing the prepare. Now, traditionally, you would also add a journal disk to this, but I don't have separate journal disks, so it should do its own journaling completely by itself. So there goes one. Didn't do the activate. They might have changed this because I did hear about this. Give me one second. Okay, so there is a mount and there's a second partition already. It looks like it doesn't fit. The prepare does both now, basically. It used to be an initial prepare and then it was a activate, but looks like that's changed. So prepare does everything now. I'm all for that. That's fine. So there's our block device that's been mounted. This guy has no block device yet. We do the deploy or the prepare, and there should be one as soon as it's done. And there it is. Now check our Ceph status on our monitor, and everything's there. Look at all the space. That is a success. Let me know if you guys have any questions. I'll be here. Talk to you all later. Have a good one. Bye-bye.